excuse me, Massport, Amber Goodspeed, and...
Anthony Gallagher.
Anthony Gallagher. I would just ask that if you have comments and questions, that you please come to the microphone in the center, and please state your name and your address when you speak. So now I'm going to turn it over to Mike.
Thank you for being here tonight at what is an informational meeting on the resurfacing project. My hope is that in the presentation, most of your questions will be answered by the information that's presented. Any, obviously anything that you need to know afterwards, come to the microphone. The selectmen have a regularly scheduled meeting at 7:30. So I'd like to ask you if you can hold your questions that apply specifically to Massport to the end. Issues about things that are happening solely on the airfield that don't involve veteran streets or veteran enforcement or anything. Because that will allow us to address all of the things that concern the selectmen while we're still here. And I realized that there was a real problem with notification of this project. I think we all dropped the ball on that. I want to personally apologize for my own failure to recognize the importance of notification. This has been on the schedule for many months, but I didn't really realize what the ground transportation aspects of it were until a few weeks ago. Nevertheless, I hope you'll accept my apology and let's try to move forward and see what we can do in a constructive way to make this as palatable as possible to the neighborhoods and the community. So I'd like to turn the microphone over to our neighbors from Massachusetts Port Authority, who will describe the origins and the purpose of the project and the reasons why Bedford is involved.
Evening, everyone. Again, my name is Amber Goodspeed. I'm the manager of airport administration for Hanscom Field. If you can't hear me, let me know and I'll try to speak up. In April 2016, we briefed the Hanscom Field Advisory Commission. It's the Hanscom Field Advisory Commission, or HVAC, is a legislated group created in 1980, and that's Massport's vehicle for getting information out to the public on a monthly basis, and we've been meeting monthly since then. And that's how we report noise and project information to our surrounding communities. So that's when we started planning the project in theory, in concept. And the project itself will consist of a full runway closure of our primary runway. That's 1129. And that's our longest runway. That's the one that's used the most. And it's a 30-day full closure. So there'll be no air traffic on the runway at all. It will be completely closed, and it will be milled. The millings will be removed from the site and overlaid with new asphalt. It's a necessary project for the safety of our aviation community, and it's been over 20 years since we last paved the runway. After the first 30 days, there will be nighttime closures for approximately 15 to 18 days during the overnight hours to do some touch-up work like paint, and that sort of thing. Otherwise, the airport will be open during the day. The second weekend of August, tentatively, you know, it's weather permitting right now, that's August 11th in the evening to August 14th in the morning. For approximately 60 hours, we'll close the airport completely. Both runways will be closed while we mill and pave the intersection of the two runways that we have at Hanscom Field. So as the project has unfolded and developed, we've worked with Bedford and the Lexington Police Departments on the traffic route details, and at the time it was determined that, you know, police detail wasn't necessary. However, you know, if at any time that the police department feels that it's necessary, or anyone feels that it's necessary to have a police detail, we would of course cover that under the project and we would arrange for a detail to take place. So I think we're between both police departments, we're sort of at a wait and see kind of place right now, but we can certainly, it's not something that's off the table. If it's needed, it's needed, and we will absolutely take care of it. A few other things, you know, questions that I've received from a few people on the phone and by email have come up, so I'm going to try to sort of answer those questions as much as I possibly can, and then if you have any additional questions, please feel free to ask. So a few of the questions that have come up, some of them have been in regards to the project environmental impacts. So it's the process for the airport is to go to the FAA, to the federal government, with an overview of the project, and that includes all impacts of the project for you know, air quality, water quality, all environmental impacts. And then the FAA team reviews that, and they either determine that you need to do some further mitigation, or that the project has what they call a finding of no significant impact, which means that they don't anticipate the environmental impacts to be heavy enough to require any additional mitigation. So earlier this year, or late last year, the FAA issued a finding of no significant impact to the project. So they didn't feel that, you know, any additional mitigation was necessary. That being said, I know a lot of people are concerned about the contractors and the trucks and the truck haul routes. So the subcontractors for the trucks are all, you know, DOT certified, they're all licensed. Most of them will be coming out of the Lowell Methuen area to the project site, and they all have stormwater mitigation plans on file and whatever plans that they have to have on file with the DOT. So for the project itself, of course, they'll all be covered. So when there's materials in the back of the truck, they will be covered. They will follow whatever regulations that they need to follow for the DOT for, you know, washing of the trucks and that sort of thing so that they're clean. If it happens that during the process of moving to or from the airfield, a contractor runs over a curb and damages a curb or something like that, we would absolutely replace the curb and fix the curb as part of the project. We wouldn't leave anything, worse off than when we found it. So that would be covered on the project as well. And if there is any time that anything happens, you know, to a curb in front of your home, please call and we can start, you know, moving things in order to take the, you know, make those repairs. A few other questions, let's see. I think we talked about the haul routes.
Can you go over that?
Yeah, so I think we're gonna talk about the haul routes next. So Mike was kind of, do you have a pointer? So Mike was kind enough to put up this map behind me. There's two sites on the airfield where contractors would be coming into and leaving the airfield for the purpose of the project. And overall, at Hanscom and at most airports, if a project is located at one point in the airfield, the objective is to get to that point on the airfield without risking the safety of, you know, the contractors, the people on the ground, or the flying public. So you always want to go to the most direct route possible. For instance, you know, we've had in the past few years, we've had a few other projects. JD Aviation has taken 2A in. The Retrix project took Virginia Road in because those were the most direct routes to the sites on the airfield. So for this particular project, the most direct routes to our sites and to the runway without impacting the safety of air traffic, they're both from Bedford. And as we were having these conversations in the past, you know, year or so with HVAC, this was in concept that, yes, we'll be going through Bedford, but the volume of traffic and that sort of thing, those details were very recent as the contractor was brought on for the project. So, all right, so the first project site right here is the Navy hangar, and next to that is a parking lot. Close the blinds. So while he's doing that, so this is the main staging site for construction right here in this parking lot. So what you're seeing here is Hartwell Road. This is Instrumentation Laboratories. Edge Sports is right here. The old, what they call the Navy hangar, is right here. So this parking lot, this whole area will be access to the airfield, and this is where they'll be accessing the runway. The runway that we're talking about is this one right here. It's our longest, most used runway. The majority of the construction traffic will be going Route 62 to Hartwell Road right into the site. A few of the rules that we've given to the contractors is that they're not allowed to stop on streets. They are to proceed directly onto the airfield. Only idling or stopping on the airfield. So we don't anticipate any traffic backups. They do have plenty of space here to the stage. Well, I mean, in the grand scheme of things for traffic around here, we hope that it doesn't add more significant traffic. But we don't anticipate them stopping on the road is the point. And then our second site is over here. So here's the entrance. This is South Road right here. And I think, is this Summer over here?
Yes.
So South Road here, at some point it goes, you know, keeps going to the north, but instead of going to the north out to Great Road, they'll be taking Summer through to Lexington out onto Hartwell Avenue, which is in Lexington, out to 128. Hey, thanks. So this is the route for this side of the airfield. And the reason for those two entrances is this is an active runway, and it's really not safe for those contractors to be going back and forth across an active runway where aircraft are landing and departing. So the work on this side of the runway will be primarily accessed, the milling and the paving will be primarily accessed through this gate. And then, you know, the rest of the project traffic will be going through this gate. We do anticipate the majority of the traffic to go through this gate. When there's nighttime closures and nighttime work in this section right here, that will all be accessed through this gate right here. So during the project, which begins tomorrow, we anticipate 4 trucks in an hour to this gate. And 4 trucks an hour is a good thing to say, but you know, in the reality, there could be bunching up on 128 and getting caught up in traffic and that sort of thing. That's just an average over the course of the project. So for, I'm sorry? 4 trucks coming out. Yes, that's right. So, you know, while we don't anticipate all the trucks to come all at once, and we hope that they don't run into traffic, we all know what the reality is on 128. So there's a possibility that, you know, those 4 trucks could come in all together, but we hope that they'll be spaced. But regardless, they will continue onto the airfield and not be backing up on South Road. So for those 30 days, those trucks will be taking millings, which is the ground up asphalt that's currently there that's breaking up now. They'll be taking that out to their plant, and then later on this week, they'll be bringing asphalt in. And they'll be paving, they'll be working on both sides of the runway at the same time. So concurrently, on the other side, they'll be bringing in materials and taking out materials through this entrance over here. The difference between the two entrances was when we were looking at the traffic impacts and the impacts on the communities, there's obviously, as you can see on the map, this is a more industrial here, and this is a more of a neighborhood situation. So we are only doing 16 hours a day through this gate. So the traffic will be from approximately 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. during the project. And they won't be coming in and out of this gate during those 8 overnight hours. This gate will be open 24 hours a day. So that's the general haul plan and the haul route. As you know, a lot of things happen with construction, weather, delays, and that sort of thing. That full runway closure, it is scheduled to be the weekend of the, let me make sure I have that right, the 11th through the 14th. However, if there's expected, you know, heavy rains or rains all weekend, then they'll move that full closure to the following weekend, which is the 18th through the 21st.
Can you give the phone number?
Yeah, so we've been emailing the town elected officials, the selectmen that are on the Hanscom Field Advisory Commission, as well as the 4 town managers and the police departments. We've been sending them a message every week when it gets updated. Every Friday afternoon, we have a project website. And usually, Anthony, can you pull up the URL for me? It's kind of a long URL. Hey, thank you. So here's what the website says right now. Can you scroll down just a little bit? Actually, that's the press release. So it's massport.com/Hanscom Field. Hanscom-Dashfield. I think it's Dashfield slash runway dash project. That link is also in the email, so if you need it, we can send it to you. Or Mike can send it to you if you have the email addresses from the group.
The most important thing is the phone number for immediate response.
Right, so I've also set up a project hotline. That's not it. Well, he's looking for the site. We set up a project hotline. The hotline is available. You'll hear me giving the most recent update on what to expect for the following week for the project, and I update that on Friday afternoons, as well as the website. The website has a percentage of the project completion, what to expect, what the schedule is for the coming week, just so you have an idea of what's happening on the airfield and what the progress of the project is. The phone number is 781-869-8060. It does ring at my desk, and when I'm there, not in meetings, and available, I will answer. Otherwise, if you do have a question, please leave me a message, and I will get back to you as soon as I can during normal business hours. And I've already gotten quite a few more phone calls than I anticipated on the phone line, so I've already got a backlog from today. but I will get back to you this week.
And if people have a complaint or concern when you're not working, should they call the Bedford Police Department and they can?
I don't want to speak for the chief of police, but they do. The Bedford Police Department does have our schedule, and they also are getting that week outlook, that week look ahead. They're getting those emails and the link to the project. Hey, thank you. So this is what the main page and then that link for the progress report will change every week. So if you click on the progress report now, this is what our progress report looks like for August 1st through August 5th. So we have our runway closure set up and where we're closing and what we're doing, what our operational impacts are also for the airport community. And then we have our project hotline number there, the link that will get updated weekly, and then the overall project schedule will be on the bottom. And of course, since we haven't started yet, it's at 0%, but we will have a percentage of completion along the way.
Ready for questions?
I think you had some other questions for me. Can you remind me? Did you have
additional questions? No, either. But I want to give the neighbors a chance I wanted to let everybody know that the selectmen certainly objected to Bedford being the main route for the truck deliveries, pickups. To a lesser degree, Lexington affected as well. And then we learned that all alternate routes were either illegal or insecure or not realistic, including access through the Air Force Base.
Yeah, actually, if I could just say, a lot of people have asked, why can't we go through the Air Force Base? And the Air Force Base, a lot of people confuse the Air Force Base and the airport. It's two separate entities, Mass Airport and the airport. That was weird. And the Air Force installation is a completely separate federal secure facility, and that's never, bringing construction vehicles through the secure facility has never really been an option for us.
We have representatives here from the Police Department and the Department of Public Works as well. So I invite individual questions on the project. Please, let's try to top load the questions that involve Bedford agencies and departments and geography. Have questions that are specifically about the airfield and activity there. Save those till later so the selectmen can hear all of your questions that they can influence. So you can use the microphone here and state your name and address for the record. Let's see if we can try to answer them all.
I think it's just speaking to it.
Hi, my name is George Payne. I live on Kendall Court, which is the area just north of the industrial area where you're saying is primarily industrial.
Can you scroll over there?
Right in there, and then of course it's more north of that, and of course all the residents on 62. So you're only, my objection to what you're saying is he only brought up the industrial area as if that was bypassing right. public.
Right.
And it's not.
Right.
Two of my grandchildren live there too. Anyway, my question has more to do with the safety aspect of twofold. One, the town habitually has a heavy rush hour traffic. I mean, stop and go traffic through it.
I'm familiar.
And so with the addition of trucks added to that stop and go traffic, and since trucks are bigger and wider, and some of the roads are very narrow, what accommodations either are or can be made to allow for emergency vehicles, fire, heart attacks, you know, all the stuff that happens, you know, day in and day out?
I mean, like above and beyond normal traffic?
Yeah. Well, I'm saying during, you know, I think possibly, I have to wait and see, that non-rush hour traffics, that may not be a problem.
Right.
Rush hour traffic, I'm sure it will be a problem. As far as speed or getting to a heart attack victim or a house on fire or something like that. What either have you thought of or what could be planned by the police or fire to accommodate those things? I have grandchildren out there. What if they get hurt? You know,
I might have to defer to the chief on that if he thinks that are there additional plans when you have regular truck traffic through there?
Good evening, folks. Rather Pongeroni, the police chief. Can everyone hear me?
Do you want to take this, chief?
Sure.
Forgive me for sending the question to you. So construction isn't my primary job description, so there's a lot of questions that you might have that I might not be able to answer. If I can't answer them today, I will absolutely go back and look for the answers for you and certainly pass that information along to Mike or to the chief as necessary, but here he is.
Thank you. That's a very good question, sir. Robert Bongiorno, your police chief. So I had a conversation with Chief Grunes today, and we've included the town manager, of course. What we're planning on doing, obviously, is following the weekly updates of where the construction is, monitoring the situation. If there does seem to be a delayed response, there's always the possibility of possibly staging some equipment so that coverage and response times are not impacted. And I think you heard from Massport tonight, they're willing to work with us if that's an issue. So we'll continue to monitor that situation. If we see that response times are delayed, we'll certainly work with Massport and possibly stage some equipment to look at the response times. So we will monitor that, sir.
You say stage equipment, I'm sorry. Does that mean you'll have stuff local to the area?
So certainly on the police side of things, we have the ability of being more fluid. If it looks like our response times are impacted by traffic, it's more easy to stage police equipment there. So that is something we could do. If it looks like our response times will be delayed to Kendall Court or the adjoining area, we can certainly look at that to accomplish that.
Can you hear me? My name is Nancy Wolk. I'm at 4 Daniels Drive. My question is actually for the Bedfire personnel. I'm very concerned about the Wilson Park area. As we go regularly, you'll notice the traffic backs up on a regular basis during rush hour. I am concerned because it's not a 90-degree angle. The trucks are going to have to go into the oncoming traffic lane. If you're coming from North Road, turning onto Concord at Wilson Park, I can't see a truck making that turn radius. They just don't have that. And then I just heard that we're not having police decals. How are we going to do this without having a gridlock in the middle of town every day?
I'm sorry, can you show me where that park is?
It's like way up.
Okay.
It's up in the center of town.
Yeah.
So is that on a regular, is it like
from North Road turning onto Concord Road. It's a very small
route. Route 4?
Yes,
right.
Route 4. And as you can see, that's not a 90-degree angle. The trucks are going to most likely turn into the oncoming traffic. Do you see what I'm saying?
Oh, I know where I take that turn every day.
Yeah. So, I mean, a car can do it, but at rush hour, that is just solid traffic. How are we going to do this without accidents, without getting a truck stuck in gridlock? I mean, this is going to be a daily occurrence. How do we deal with this for 30 days?
Sure, so, again, certainly a very good...
In the morning, that is totally business of nightmare. I don't think any trucks, like four trucks a day, is always feasible.
You're going to try to do this one at
25 to 4 is a complete mess in the morning. I don't think how we can figure that out in the morning for trucks to go through that road from 62 to 25 to 4.
So, certainly a very legitimate concern. We all know that Wilson Park is heavily traveled and congested. I don't know the answer to this, so I'm going to put Massport. I would assume that prior to defining the route, that the operators of the trucks actually drove the routes and surveyed it. So I think that if there was an issue, I don't know if that was factored into their decision. But this is certainly an area, if it's a concern to the community, I think you heard that Massport is willing to work with us. We have our staff here. We can certainly deploy resources there and assist the vehicle traffic, pedestrian traffic, and the motoring public if it makes the community safer. The feedback is such.
So the contractors have driven the route. I know I personally have been behind quite a few big trucks out there, and I see them make the turn. Sometimes it's tight, but I have seen them make the turn. These particular trucks, they're dump trucks, they're triaxle dump trucks. So they're not, we're not talking about like 18-wheelers. They're dump trucks. Like I said before, where, if it becomes an issue that we're adding too much to traffic, we're certainly willing to work with the police department if something's needed there. But in terms of the traffic that's already there, I'm not sure that I can do anything about that. I wish I could, because I drive that every day too. I know this project is, it's going to be tough on all of us.
Thank you. I would just like Bedford Police and Bedford Town Selectmen to be aware of that and keep an eye on it in the coming days, and if we do need a detail, to act on that quickly. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll keep an eye on that. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Norm Ross, and I live in Broad, and I reside at the FAM camp. You could put the FAM camp up there for a minute. It's at the end of South Road.
Let's go close to the airport.
Well, we're looking for the picture. When you come down South Road and come into the FAM camp, there's a 90-degree turn. There's also a space there where the Jersey barriers are that could be removed and put a gate there and have the trucks be backed up on the airfield and not in the FAM camp side of the road if they get backed up. We have some 60 vehicles there coming and going every day. And if they can't get out or somebody can't get in, then we've created a real logjam. But if we can get in right underneath the Hanscom FAM camp sign there, that they can go right there where it says South Road, they've got all of that road to work with and stay out of the FAM camp.
Are you Mr. Ross?
Yes, I am.
We talked to Mrs. Ross recently, I think. Our contractor did out there the other day. He said he did anyways. And there was a discussion about how,
I went out and visited with him. And again, it's 90-degree turns, as the young lady behind me mentioned. There's two 90-degree turns to get on the camp.
There are, yeah.
That would get into the campground. There's a propane tank at one of the turns if they wanted to go in that gate. And then there's the water treatment plant is up at the next road where they would be turning in. And so coming straight in South Road and going onto the airfield side would maybe relieve 200 yards of traffic on the road.
Our contractor spent Friday out there taking a look at the site, and it's something we're definitely going to keep an eye on to see if we need to find an alternate route in. If they feel that they can get in without any issues. So if it does become a problem, you have my number, and we'll certainly go out there and address it. I feel like
everybody else's concern is not the turns, it's the amount of traffic, and if they were backed up.
Right, no, so the airfield gate is out there. on the other side. So the rule with the with the tracks.
Where I had the point of the road that turns right when you go into the fam camp, go up further, up, back down. That's the entrance to the fam camp for the office and all that. There's a propane tank on that corner. You can see the picture. And that's not 100 yards from the end of that road to the propane tank. And everybody else trying to get out or come in, if they came in down here at South Road at that access, there'd be free movement and nobody would be blocking anybody. And I know that the,
I appreciate your suggestion. The fam camp is outside the jurisdiction of the town of Bedford, so I hope you can discuss that afterwards with the Massport representatives.
Yeah.
I'd like to try to clear up any questions that involve Bedford jurisdiction while we have a chance.
And Mr. Ross, we have looked at it, and we do know that the trucks plan to continue all the way through. There's no stopping there. So if you do find that there is any stopping, please give me a call, and we'll go out there and take a look at it and see if we can make sure that those trucks aren't stopping out there.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Patty Dahlgren of 383 South Road, Bedford.
And Patty, nice to meet you.
Hi, it's great to meet you. I just want to say thank you very much for coming together at the last minute to give us this forum to express our concerns. And thank you very much, Massport, for stating today that whatever police details are needed, that you will work with our town and with Lexington to ensure that we do have those police details. Do I understand that correctly?
You do understand that correctly. And in addition, you're concerned about damage to roads and that sort of thing.
Yes.
If there's anything that we cause, we absolutely plan to go back and fix it. So let us know, send me a picture, you know, we'll go out there and take a look. If there's something that wasn't already there for damage and we've caused it, we'll certainly take care of it and fix those at our expense.
I really appreciate that, and I'm sure the town does as well. So it sounds like what people need to do then is document the existing situation so that if damage is done, that we'll be able to verify it. Is that a good idea?
It is a good idea. My operations manager and I were hoping to go out there tomorrow and with our GoPro and just drive the route and take a look at how things look out there now.
Great. I was also wondering if you would be able to provide us with a copy of the rules that you have given your contractors.
Okay.
So that we understand whether or not they're in violation.
Okay.
Two more questions. After business hours, when you are understandably not answering the line, should we in fact call the Bedford Police Department?
Yes, we encourage you to do that. Again, we are here to service our community, so we would encourage you to call us with any safety issues as you would typically would. After tonight, our staff will be sending a memo to our dispatchers on how to receive that. So we encourage that. And if we can resolve the issue immediately, we will. If not, we certainly will follow up with Massport for our residents.
Thank you, Chief. My last question, actually I have two more. Who is responsible for monitoring compliance to policy? I so appreciate hearing that the operations are going to run down the route by Summer Street and South Road only from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. Does that mean the gate is going to be locked? Who's monitoring that compliance?
So the contract team will be monitoring that.
So they're self-monitoring?
Yeah, but we're there. We have operations staff on duty 24 hours a day as well. So they would know if anything was amiss, okay, so to speak. It's tough to say with the contract schedule when weather issues happen and that sort of thing happens. This is the schedule as it stands now. We all know that in New England especially, if you don't like the weather, you can wait a minute. And we're hoping that the weather cooperates with us for the rest of August and that everything rolls along smoothly without a hitch. But we did put the plan, the project, the hotline in place and the website in place so that we could update you if, you know, anything does change on the schedule, and that would include the nighttime hours. But it's not their intention to use that gate at night, because we did see, you know, we do realize that there's an impact over there. And I know that the schedule is tough. It's a tight schedule. Last time we did the runway, it was a 90-day project. None of the management staff at Hanscom Field were there at that time, but we've heard a lot of stories about sort of the heartburn that happened with that project. So we did our best to try to be more considerate and the schedule, and have the bulk of the schedule finished before school starts, which I understand first day is September 5th, I think. So, you know, hopefully that alleviates some headaches as well.
I haven't heard anything about automatic traffic counters, so that we, while I understand that the construction project has an estimated number of trips and an estimated number of trucks, we're not going to really have any way, if only for the next project, to ascertain how much, if at all, this has grown beyond the scope that was defined to our town officials.
So I know that we would know in the because the contractor is keeping track of, obviously they're paying all of those truck trips. So they're going to be keeping track of that in terms of the dollars and cents, so they'll have a count. We don't have any traffic counters or a plan for traffic counters on the streets in place.
Is that something?
We don't have any counts for what the traffic exists, you know, what traffic exists now. So what would we be comparing it to?
I don't think you'd need to compare it to the existing traffic. If you place the automatic traffic counter directly at the very entrance to the Hanscom Field from both routes, then you're not dealing with campers from the fam camp or any other miscellaneous traffic. What you'd be doing is getting a count of the traffic only going in for that project.
Okay. Well, we didn't have any plans in place to do that. Did you do that for Logan for their project?
They did for the Big Dig and Spectacle Island, and they routinely use them.
They just did a runway project for Logan as well, and specific traffic counters weren't used for that. Generally, in the industry, the reportable numbers tend to reconcile that traffic count, but I can certainly look into this.
How will we know if you have determined, I'm asking very vigorously for automatic traffic counters. I think it's critical because without those, we don't have the data, and our town officials don't have any idea what the full accurate scope of this project is. So I'm going to sit down. I just want to say thank you very much. And I actually came up through Wilson Park while a very large truck holding a bulldozer on it was on it. And I have a photograph of it. It stopped traffic. It did come into the oncoming lane. We all had to back up. And the project hasn't even started yet. So I just want to say thank you very much. I understand that this project is a big deal, and I really appreciate everybody's willingness to work with us. Thank you.
It's nice to meet you in person, Patty. Call me anytime. We've already spoken on the phone. I'm not sure if that was for our project. I know there's a lot of other projects going on in Bedford as well, but we're definitely interested in keeping track of what's going on with our project for sure.
Hi, my name is Rich Doherty. Excuse me. None of this is going to impact me very much, except trying to get my daughter to and from granddaughter to and from Davis School. So I'd like to confirm some of the analytics that's been reported by you folks and by the Bedford Citizen. All total, during a 6-week period, it looks like we're gonna have something close to 9,000 truck trips into Bedford. Is that about right?
So, yeah, that's about right.
But those are
they're split between the two sites.
Half of that, because the number of truck movements, one in, one out, it's two.
So it's 18,000 trips?
No, it's 9,000 trips, but only 4,500 in, 4,500 out.
Okay, so there's 9,000 trucks going or coming to the project.
So actually, Mike, let me just correct that a little bit. So on one side, we have about 5,500 truck movements for the duration of the project. Yeah. On the South Road side, we have a little bit over, I think, 4,000 total for the project.
So that's 9,000 total trips, Mike, is what I'm coming to. So if that's the case, and is the project still planned for about 6 weeks? Is that about right?
So yeah, it's the 30-day closure, and then it's almost 3 weeks after that, where we'll be doing the overnight work. But most of the truck traffic will happen in that 30 days.
30 days?
So the 30-day period is when we're experiencing all the heavy truck traffic, where we're bringing in asphalt for pavement and taking out the old pavement. The rest of the truck traffic would just be, you know, specialized trucks for grinding grooves in the runway, paint trucks to paint the lines in the runway and that sort of thing for the rest of the project. But the bulk of the truck traffic is those 30 days, August 1st through August 30th.
So that would be about 300 trips a day. Okay.
You caught me, I need a calculator.
Well, 9,000 divided by 300 is 36. Divided by 30 is 300. So if that's the case, there's something on the order of 11 or 12 truck trips per hour. And about a third of them are down South Road, and the other third are out through Hartwell Avenue. Is that about right? I mean, you have the two-thirds?
I'm not sure that that's exact, but...
What I'm getting at is, if you look at it, there's about a truck an hour going up and down the South Road. There's about two trucks an hour, or four trucks an hour going up and down North Road and Hartwell. Is that in that...
So there's about four trucks an hour going into the South Road.
And
that's fewer than are going to the Hartwell Road site.
Okay, I thought it was...
It's about 5,500 trucks total for the duration of the project going to Hartwell Road. And then it's a little over 4,000 total going to South Road.
Okay, so there's fewer going down South Road.
Correct.
Okay, so it's a couple an hour. That's what I'm trying to get at. What really is the impact, Chief?
So we looked at the impact for South Road over the 16-hour period each day, and we figured that to be 69 trucks a day at the South Road entrance, which turns, for the 16 hours, it ends up being about four trucks in, four trucks out.
Eight an hour,
and then more up and down North Road, Concord Road, and Harbor Road.
Yeah.
So, all right, that's...
So, is there a question? Do you have a question?
Well, yeah, the question is, relative to the current traffic, about how much more is that? Do you have
Which I actually do have that.
Okay.
Thanks to the Department of Public Works. On North Road, the average daily traffic count is 14,350. It peaks in the afternoon at 1,500 an hour. It peaks in the morning at 1,375. Concord Road, similarly, average daily 9,900. Average hourly 1,200. So it's about a little less than 1% increase, if you look at it that way.
So what's your increase, Mike, about?
Well, I mean, if we're talking 11 to 12 trucks per hour, 24 hours a day, that's 260 trips for 24 hours on North Road, where the average daily count is over 14,000.
Okay. So the increase is not significant except for trucks. And that's about the only significant.
The size of them.
So that gives us a feel for about how many trucks to look for, get out of the way of, or plan for school buses, those kinds of things. Can someone once again explain to us the analytics and the issue of coming down 128, because that's where the South Road trucks come from, right? Off of 128?
That's correct.
Why can't they all go down 128? Over Route 2A on roads that handle truck traffic and into Hanson Field in the front. Well, someone said an analysis, but I don't remember why we can't do that.
I think I mentioned that earlier on in the evening, is that if a car came down 2A, or a truck came down 2A and down to, I'm gonna turn, excuse me.
On the front entrance of
you can just zoom out one, I think we'll be good. So here's 2A, here's Hanscom Drive, here's the Civil Air Terminal. The gate to get across the airfield would be here. They would have to cross an active runway.
Thank
you. Give us just a minute, right? Sorry. All right, so they'd have to cross one active runway that's there's active aircraft movements on. Actually, all of our 100% of our traffic will be on now because the other runway is closed. And they'll also have to cross a couple of active taxiways as well. Even the access roads around the outside of the airfield go through areas where you have to stop and wait for aircraft movements. And it's not feasible or safe for us to go that way, all the way across the airfield to the site. And as I mentioned earlier, we try to make it so that we're not crossing as little paths with aircraft as possible to make it as safe for all of us.
Okay, so temporary entrances off, say, Virginia Road into the runway area is not a feasible.
So there's no entrance that at Virginia Road that wouldn't cross an active aircraft movement area?
I'm not seeing that. The active aircraft.
So the Virginia Road entrance comes in before Retrix, so it would cross the Retrix ramp where there's a bunch of aircraft movement, and then it would go across the T hangars where there's aircraft coming in and out into the taxiway there. So there's a taxiway here, and then these are T hangars where aircraft are coming in and out onto the taxiway. This is Retrix, and they have a big ramp there, and there's a bunch of jets coming in and out from there as
so,
well.
So the
entrance is here,
okay.
And then there's a T hangar entrance here, but they would still be going around the T hangars. There's not a lot of there's not a lot of room for aircraft and trucks here.
So the issue is not the access along 2A, it's the movement after you get to the field.
Right, exactly. So which is why we plan all of our projects to have access at the closest point to the site so that we're not mixing aircraft with vehicles, which is very unsafe.
I mean, I hear you saying that, and I guess I agree. Thanks.
You know, when you look at it from an overview, it looks like there would be a lot of access, but when you are actually out there, a lot of those wooded areas and stuff, there's not a lot of gates to get in from public roads onto the airfield. We have the airbase on one side. We have the South Rota entrance, the Hartwell entrance. The T-hangers aren't really feasible for us. And like I mentioned before, other projects come in from the site that leaves them traveling on the active aircraft movement areas the least. So for other projects, we go in 2A, but for this one, it's just not feasible.
Okay, I guess that explains why you have to drive through a town instead of through the country. Pretty much so. Thank
you. Well, all of the other traffic for the jet aviation project is 2A.
We've delayed the start of the selectmen's meeting for another 10 minutes or so, the conversation will continue without the selectmen, but if we can concentrate the Bedford issues now, that would be helpful.
Hi.
Actually, I think you should stay here because we don't want to miss the selectmen meeting after we're done.
Hi, my name is Ron Green, and I'm not affected by proximity to this project at all, but I got curious the other night when I was at a meeting of the HATS group, and Mike and Amber, I asked you the question, where does all the
HATS spot go? So
and
you
I
did.
The answer I got was it goes to Lowell.
It does. It does go to Lowell.
Sure something happened.
I did actually look into that after you asked me the question. So Ron at the HATS meeting, for everyone else's benefit, asked me why we couldn't have a plant on site to recycle. From what I understand, that's a huge undertaking to build a plant and actually turn the materials into reusable materials. I don't think that the residents would appreciate the air quality implications of that, for sure.
So it's
not something that we would have considered for the project. I did ask.
As I looked at it a little bit further, you look at what's going on 128, and I don't think, maybe they do, I'm not an engineer, but like my friend Rich Doherty might say, they have something that looks like a road Zamboni on 128 that chews up the asphalt and then it spits it out the other end as new asphalt. Is that some of the vehicles you're considering at this repaving job?
I know we have something that the milling machine looks like that, but it doesn't make new asphalt. It just crumbles
it
up so we can take it out.
It does, because it doesn't look as though, or it doesn't appear as though, any asphalt is being trucked away from Route 128.
I have no idea what they're doing on 128.
I think the other consideration is procurement. This contract was probably signed months ago. And so I don't think it can be changed at the 11th hour in terms of the inventory. You may very well have a more creative way to do it. Maybe technologically didn't even exist when they signed the contract.
Well, they appear to be asphalting machines that go down 128, and they appear to get the material from the road itself is what it looks like. Now, I'm not an engineer. If there were an engineer here that could answer that, maybe I could go home satisfied.
I'm not an engineer, but I think sometimes that's the difference between just resurfacing and rebuilding of a road. So I'm not sure that the truck that you're describing is actually doing exactly what...
What it looks like.
Yeah, there's some aspects of that, but the essentially recycling of asphalt is an involved process, but technologically, yeah. Outside, we're not quite there.
It just strikes me as a money-saving operation all around.
We are reusing some of the material. We're keeping some of the material on site to use as base material, so not all of it is getting trucked out.
Thank you.
Hi, I'll just stand up here. I'm Lee Borderer from 42 Fletcher Road, and like some of the other speakers, directly I'm not going to be impacted. But my question, that's okay, I can follow moving out to, is for the DPW. Is there somebody here from the DPW?
They're saying yes.
Okay. I don't know much about streets, but it seems to me not only do we have these three-axle trucks, but they're three-axle trucks full of asphalt, weighing some number of pounds, probably many. And I'm wondering if all of the roads, particularly the ones around summer, are built, constructed, whatever the right word would be, to handle four of those every hour for 14 hours for 30 days. Follow-up question is, let's hope they are. How is it going to be possible to determine damage on those roads and attribute it to Hanscom repaving thingy and not just the fact that roads get old and they get potholes and they get cracked and they get fixed? So while I appreciate the offer, I think it's terrific that you're going to fix stuff that you break. How are we going to know if they break it? Thanks.
I have to say, I don't work for the DPW either, so we haven't determined that yet, but
yeah.
Go ahead, Mike.
Town Engineer Adrian St. John Mazur.
Good evening. So, truck traffic, actually, just as a point of fact, is significantly more damaging than vehicles. However, the roads in Bedford, as in most communities, are built on a suitable subbase, gravel subbase, binder, and top course. You may recall that, for those of you who live near the site, know that we are currently paving Hartwell Road from South Road to Estigley Athena. New Hot Top definitely would have been affected by the truck traffic. However, the existing roads, South Road and the westerly end of Hartwell Road, will be fine for this project.
And Summer Street.
And Summer Street, yeah.
Thanks, Adrian. We did meet with Adrian.
Too.
And I think, Adrian, I believe, if you could wait, you're repaving that road afterwards, correct? You had a project in
correct.
Hartwell Road.
So the section of Hartwell, of course, construction to Wendland, is the gas company is working on Hartwell Road. So when they are done, we will be repaving the section of Hartwell Road from basically IL, where we finished recently, over to Athena Lane, where we'll be repaving this week. So there's a section of Hartwell Road that they'll be traveling on that will be paved. If the gas company works quickly enough, we'll be paving it this year. If not, it'll be more like in the spring.
Hi. Rick Blue. I live on 384 South Road, and I am directly impacted.
Can you
hear me?
Yes.
So, my name is Rick Blue. I live on 384 South Road, so I am directly impacted, in fact, very much so. But specific to the roads issue, a couple of questions. One, I just want to clarify. I thought I heard you mentioned that there's 4,000 trucks expected down South Road. Is that correct, or did I miss
it? That is correct.
Okay, because
over the duration.
Initially, we had understood it was only 1,300 trucks that are coming in.
That's correct.
So where's the increase, and what happened within the last couple of days?
So Mike and I were just going over the numbers today. There was, I think that's probably my mistake on the exact numbers, not knowing the magnitude of the project when we first started discussing it. So now that I've gotten the details from the contractor, I have all the estimated numbers.
That's why we need an automatic traffic counter.
Without one, we will never know. There could be 100,000 trucks and no one will know. That could have went from 1,300 to
2,000. Comment if it's relevant. We can't hear it though.
The fact that we went from 1,300 trucks to 4,000 between yesterday and today is exactly why we need an automatic traffic counter, so that our town officials know exactly what's happening, and we can address this not only for this project but for future projects. Thank you.
I don't think they're going to give us any truckloads for free though, so I know that they'll charge us for it. So they'll be per truckload on the on our paperwork.
Well, to follow up on that question of what Patty had said earlier, right, if you think about the number of increases and the safety factor, because South Road is a very quiet end of the street road. There are people walking their dogs, children playing constantly, right? If we're not monitoring any of that, especially speed, we haven't even talked about speed monitoring, how do we know? We know these trucks are working to finish a project as quickly as possible, and no one is watching the speed in which they're traveling in order to get in and out. How do we ensure safety of the pedestrians and the residents?
So that certainly is an area of concern for us, quite frankly. The safety of our community is imperative. These are all issues that we've discussed internally, especially with the quality of life. At this point, what I can say is that we are looking very closely. We want to work with our residents. We want input. I think you've heard tonight that Massport is ready and willing and able to meet the demands of the citizens. So if it does turn into an issue, please contact the police department, contact Massport. We want to work with you on these issues.
So assuming that there is an issue, we report it, how quickly can we get a response in terms of getting police detail on site?
So typically, a police detail, we could have an officer there within hours. And this is one of the things that we will be meeting with directly after this meeting tonight. We'll have an internal meeting at the police department to discuss the issues of the community. And then we'll have a plan in place to monitor that, working with Massport and town officials. So your input is imperative. If you do see an issue, I would encourage you to contact us. Again, this is a Massport project. Does impact our community, and as a police department, we want to be responsive to our community as well as our elected and appointed officials.
How many police details, as of right now, are scheduled?
How many police details, as of right now, are scheduled for traffic beginning tomorrow?
So right now, we do not have any details scheduled because we wanted the feedback of the community. We wanted to listen to where the community concerns were, but that doesn't mean if tonight Massport is willing and able that we couldn't have details available to mitigate. We just don't know what we had discussions with that. We just didn't know where the work was going to be tomorrow. We didn't know if there was actually a need for police details because of we didn't know if the operation would be at 100% with respect to the traffic and the vehicles and the trucks.
I spoke with the contractor earlier today. He doesn't expect a full-on startup tomorrow either, so we do have some trucks.
So there was discussion to put police details, and we actually held off because we didn't think that the trucks would be on the route, so we wanted to maximize the efforts of the police details.
Wow.
I can understand that. I live on a 25-mile-per-hour road myself, and there's construction traffic going on where I live. And I walk my dog there every day, and I have kids, and I can certainly understand the concern. I have concerns in my own community about this kind of activity. So it's going to be tough on all of us, but I think, at some point we need to have at least a little bit of a wait and see.
It's going to be a great deal tougher without a single police detail tomorrow when construction starts. I am stunned that this town, hearing that there's going to be 4,000 trucks.
We can't do it this way. Okay, we can't do it.
Okay.
Can you make it?
My name is Carrie Tilney, and I live in Bedford, so I am affected by this. I have two quick questions for you. What's your plan? We've had a really wet summer. What's your plan, not if weather hits, but when weather hits? Do you extend your deadlines, or do you go to a 24/7 work schedule?
So, if, as I was saying earlier, if weather hits and it adds more than a few days to the schedule, then they're going to have to increase their work hours.
So your deadline then will extend?
I don't think that the deadline will extend.
Deadlines tend not to move. My other question is, we're talking about runway 1129, and you've said that it's been 20 years since the last paving.
Over 20 years, yes.
Over 20 years. Do you anticipate repaving that?
So runway 523 was last paved in 2002. And on our five-year capital program, the repavement of that is not in our outlook yet, so not within the next 5 years.
And then my last question is, we'll watch out for kid safety, we'll watch out for response time, we'll watch out for potholes, we'll watch out for damages to our homes, we'll watch out for traffic issues, we'll watch out for potholes. What's Massport doing to anticipate any of that? Will you be on the routes occasionally during the day?
I mean, we worked on this project with the contractors and with the field advisory.
That's what you've done.
To anticipate a lot of traffic issues and that sort of thing. We're all going to be out there tomorrow watching the process.
Okay, so you'll be along these routes periodically. We should anticipate seeing Massport vehicles.
I don't drive a Massport vehicle, but I'll be out there.
Okay. All right, thank you. So at this time, I'm sorry to say that selectmen are going to have to adjourn to our regularly scheduled meeting because we do have folks waiting for us there. However, our assistant town manager will continue to be here, and I know I think Mike is going to stick around for a few more minutes. And so certainly anything that is said after we leave, the messages will be conveyed to the selectmen.
Sorry about this, but I lived here for 14 years. It's my first town meeting. The selectmen, of course, running opposed, should stick around because I have questions.
The selectmen didn't
know
when we
were notified. The selectmen didn't send out notifications
of it. If you, one of the things that is a guiding principle at all government meetings here, regardless of the level of emotion, is civil discourse and respect in between the parties. And so I just want to reemphasize that we're going to be accessible to everyone. This was an emergency meeting that was called. We're trying to accommodate everybody within the context of our regularly scheduled meeting. Town officials will remain here. Massport will remain here. I'll stay a little bit longer. My phone number is 781-275-8074. Feel free to call me after our meeting or tomorrow or any other day.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Mike. And I would just also add, this is being taped by Bedford TV, so we will all have an opportunity to review all of the comments that are made after we have departed. Thank you.
You get a one-day notice for this. It's all okay. Playing that's important. It's all important.
Please, we're glad to hear comments along with you.
Hi, my name is Joyce. I live on Linfield Street. Hi, I'm Joyce, and I live on Linfield Street. I have two questions. First, lighting and noise. I haven't heard that brought up tonight.
Lighting in terms of lighting at the construction site? There will be work lights.
Yes.
Starting this evening, they're turning off all of the electrical circuits on the runway. So it will be work lights, and then there will be a lighted X placed at the end of each end of the runway.
Well, you know when they do jobs on 128 or wherever, they have these big, tall lamp lights that
make it like daylight.
If they're working at nighttime, aren't they going to need that?
So there will be lights on the airfield at the project, but I'm not certain that they would affect your home being so far away.
I'm not that far away, believe me. The runway is right in my backyard.
Is it?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, Mike, and then noise.
So,
when they're using the guillotine, I guess, to chop.
Oh, there's no guillotine. It's a different machine than. So, were you here when they did it back in the 90s?
Yes.
So, that was a different story. That's not the machine that they use anymore.
You didn't do it during the evening, you only did it during the day. At that point in time, I was working full time.
Right. The machine that they don't use a guillotine anymore. What they had to break up then was concrete, 12 inches thick. This is 4 inches thick asphalt. So it's more of a grinder kind of noise. It's not what they don't use what they call a guillotine anymore, and they're not using that for this project.
Well, when the truck's backing up to, will I be hearing the beep, beep, beep all night?
Probably no more so than you would hear our plow trucks in the winter.
I know we have plow trucks.
Good.
One last question on South Road. I don't know when they're going to start back up, but when they play soccer in the soccer field on South Road, the parking lot there is not large enough to accommodate all the cars, so they park all up and down South Road and on my street, Bayette Road. You'll never get a truck down.
I guess it's something we're going to have to think about when we
That's a question for the chief.
Certainly. We will reach out to the Recreation Department to see when soccer begins. That was something, that's an excellent point. And we will, Sergeant Unzis, we will certainly contact the Recreation Director and find out when that soccer season begins, and we will work through that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Amy Lloyd. I don't think that Massport appreciates the impact that this will have to the Fayette Road, Linfield neighborhood. I lived there for a decade up until a year and a half ago. Rick is absolutely correct. It is a quiet, kids playing in the street, people walking their dogs kind of neighborhood. And even the larger Arties that come down to the fan camp have kind of an impact because they can roar down there a little fast. A many ton asphalt truck will be a huge impact. And when you said to the lady before me that she lives on in Linfield, but she lives so far away, I can tell you it is not far away.
Okay.
Every plane we hear, I did hear the plow trucks. I hear the what I always talk about, what I always jokingly call the stealth plane at 1 a.m. that always took off.
And you live on Linfield?
I lived on Fayette Road for a decade up until a year and a half ago.
Okay.
So I can just tell you that the impact to that neighborhood will be significant. Forgive me, I had a previous thing and I wasn't able to come to the beginning of the meeting, but one of my questions was, at the eastern end of the runway, you have an area that doesn't have a taxiway. Was that addressed, why that can't be a staging area? And let me sort of preface that with another question. I'm assuming your staging at the fan camp isn't taking over the fan camp. It's going to have to be within the fan
camp. We're not staging at the fan camp.
So you're going inside the fence.
We're going inside the fence to stage. There'll be no staging outside
okay,
of any aircraft airport
so
property.
So you're staging in, not on asphalt, essentially. So you've got a similar situation at the end of the runway with a bridge access over to a road. If you scroll so we can see south of there, a smidgen, please. So right there. You can see at the end of the runway.
Where are you talking about?
Far eastern end of the runway.
I don't have the pointer.
Arrow up.
So the very end of the runway on
yes,
the far right.
Yes, right in there. You've got a bridge that goes over into the office buildings that are on the base.
There's a stream there.
Is there
so you can't actually drive from one side to the other.
There's not a bridge across there?
You're talking about this area?
Yes, I am.
That's through the Air Force Base, you mean?
Yes, it is.
We did cover that before you got here.
When the accident happened about 4 or 5 years ago, mm-hmm. the emergency vehicles accessed that way.
Right, so the Air Force Base is a secure federal facility.
The whole airport is a secure federal facility. I mean,
no, actually, the airport itself is owned by the state of Massachusetts.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
The Massachusetts Port Authority.
But it is a secure area, right? The whole airport is
so
a secured area.
The airport is a secured area, but the security regulations for the airport and the security regulations for the Air Force Base are completely different. And that, you know, taking construction vehicles for a project through a secure area like that is never an option. It's a federal facility that they already have a backup at both ends, so it wouldn't necessarily be a good idea for us to burden them by even asking.
Mike, I have one question for you then. Do I understand correctly that the town has been for a number of years and is still seeking Massport to release the section of Hartwell Road that they own that we don't?
No, it's not. I don't believe there's any active effort to do that. Part of it is also, I think, federal property as well. With all of the priorities that town has, that's not high on the agenda.
Were we at one time trying to seek that so that we could legally maintain the road since it's so poorly maintained on the Massport-owned area?
That's being, I think that's being addressed independently of that. I think that's part of what's going on right now.
We're pitching in for the repavement project on Hartwell Road.
You're pitching in?
We are, Massport is.
Is Massport doing the repaving?
Bedford is doing it.
When the construction is done, presumably?
Bedford is paving the road. We're pitching in to pay for a portion of the road.
So, okay, I thought that...
And there's also portions of the road that are on the federal government, too.
But it's the, you're talking about the Concord Road leg?
No, we're talking about Hartwell Road. That's what you're talking about, right?
Hartwell Road that goes
down. So that's the only road that we, the small piece of road that we own is that corner of Hartwell Road.
Right.
And then the lot next to us is owned by the federal government, too, so that's another...
Yes, I'm aware.
But we had a project in the works independent of this.
Okay.
Where we were planning on repaving our portion of that road. And Bedford said that they were repaving there, so we decided to pitch in at the same time and do it at the same time.
Yes, Mike, that's true.
Yes, it is. And the western side of Harbor Road, at some point, will be completely rebuilt. What we did last time was just resurface it. So,
right.
In a way, it's good that that we haven't done that.
Thank you.
My name is Barbara Anderson. I live at 385 South Road, so we will be directly impacted. We're actually next door to the Dahlgrens and across the street from where we spoke earlier. I have a question for the Chief of Police. In the, there's no details planned, but can we ask for an increased presence right from day one to monitor? We have one sign from a previous construction project that says construction vehicles 20 miles an hour. Can we get more of those, and can that be closely followed? Because if you haven't been down South Road on our end, it's a narrow, winding road with no sidewalks.
So Massport said that they will put out some more signage, and we will certainly have an increased presence. But again, this being a Massport project, we certainly don't want to, cost-wise, we want to make sure that Massport pays for anything above and beyond for police details. So.
Yeah, because we're concerned. Our houses are right at the curve on South Road, and it's a blind curve. We have some mirrors up to help. But if they're coming down fast, it's very dangerous.
Absolutely. We will certainly take note of that, and we will work with Massport to make sure that you have the appropriate signage. And if that's not accomplished, I would encourage you to contact me directly, and I will make sure that that gets done as soon as possible.
Thank you, Chief.
Hello, I'm Cheryl Mastromatio of Illinois. I live at 7 Withrop Ave. I grew up in Bedford. I'm here today because anything that impacts Bedford definitely impacts me. My first question is to Massport. My home is directly in the flight path of runway 523. So I'd like to know what traffic studies you've done on the air impact from this project.
So we do
have a lot more air traffic coming over that runway. We don't want an air catastrophe. You're probably going to be having larger planes coming in that may or may not be capable of making that landing. There's a lot of things to be considered. Plus, that's going to impact residents in the area because that is going to increase air traffic. The planes already come down very low at times for making that approach. And I'd like to know what number planes you expect to have as an increase.
So as I mentioned earlier in the meeting, that runway will get 100% of our air traffic while runway 1129 is closed. Larger aircraft that don't feel that it's safe enough for them to land won't land. We do have a few tenants who've decided to make alternative arrangements and go to other airports or just not use their aircraft during that time. So last year we had 121,000 aircraft operations for the aircraft for the airport as a whole for the entire year. So we expect normally 523 gets about 20 to 30% of our air traffic based on weather patterns. So you can expect that runway for that month will get 100% of our traffic.
So what do you expect in terms of numbers for that?
I don't have numbers off the top of my head.
Didn't do a study at all to determine what kind of amount of traffic would come over that runway?
I know that our capital programs team did study that and submit that information when they did our paperwork, but I'm not certain what it is off the top of my head.
Would you be able to get me that information? I would like to know a number in terms of numbers of planes you expect to come overhead.
Sure. I can get you an estimate, but you can never,
I understand.
I mean, you don't know until it happens.
And also, will the air traffic be limited in terms of time when they can come overhead? I know that in the past there was like a fine for anybody after 11 p.m. Is that still going to be enforced?
Yes, that's still being enforced. It's not a fine. It's a nighttime field use fee. It's a long-held fee that we've had here. We've been lucky enough to have here in place at Hanscom. Whereas other airports in the country now, that's it's a grandfathered regulation. Nowadays, it's illegal across the country. So because we haven't changed the structure of the fine and the times that we, you know, the fee and the times that we administer the fee, then we're still allowed to have that as a deterrent. That doesn't mean that they're not allowed to land. We do receive federal funding, so we're not allowed to tell an aircraft that they're not allowed to land there. But it, you know, they do get that fee, that fine, and it's from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. So if aircraft lands,
my other concerns Hartwell Road. I don't think you've really looked at the full impact on Hartwell Road. One, you've got the Edge Sports Center there. That is a very, very busy place. There's a lot of traffic down Hartwell Road because of the Edge Sports Center. They have hockey tournaments. There's a lot of things going on in that athletic field. I'm also concerned air quality for athletes that are playing soccer at those fields. I don't know if any of that was factored in, but if you're going to be having big trucks coming up and down that road, that's going to be an issue too, because you've got a lot of traffic that originates out of the Edge. Was that considered when you looked at this whole proposal?
Yeah, we own the Edge Sports land.
Pardon?
We own the Edge Sports property, so
yes,
we're aware
I know
that Edge Sports is there.
I know you did you
as part of the project,
the
they
impact?
Did consider it, yes.
Okay. And then what about the gates? You mentioned that the gate at that Hartwell was going to be open 24 hours. What kind of security have you planned for that? You don't want an open gate there that anybody can just come in and out of.
We have badge security personnel standing there.
Okay, and there'll be somebody there 24/7?
There will be personnel there 24/7.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Hi, Bob Dorr, 2 Otis Street, Bedford, and I'm only impacted by the increase in traffic on the alternate runway or second crosswalk.
The air traffic?
But my question, comment to the Chief Mongiorno and a question to Massport. I totally understand the Chief's concern about his budget, and he's kind of hedging his comments because clearly Massport has not yet committed to paying for any details or extra
fees
present. So, okay, my question would be, tonight, can you commit to the first day that you think you're going to have significant traffic? I understand you have to spool up, but the first day you're going to see significant trucks coming on to deal with the grinders and the pavement, to have not only a police detail, and I don't know the subtlety of the question, but I think you need a police cruiser there, and the detail may or may not have a cruiser, but if you had cruisers in the South Road, in particular the very sensitive area with the young children, but also Hartwell Road, further down by Chipman Farm. With a cruiser presence, the truckers are, number one, the police are gonna be much better about determining whether there's a safety issue than expecting the citizens to have to call up. Plus, you have an instant response. So if you're tonight willing to commit to paying for police details, until you can assess it after a week or two, but commit to a police detail, and actually, I think it'd be better if you also committed to a cruiser, because I know that's actually more expensive. It might be overtime, given the shift that the chief has to the staff. But if you could commit to that tonight, to this public audience, I think that would go a long way.
I personally can't commit to it, but I know that Massport is committed to working with Bedford. We've been working with the town of Bedford, especially in more detail as these details have come out in the past month. And we were in a position that if the town of Bedford decides that we need it, then we'll certainly put it in place and pay for it. I don't necessarily know that I'm authorized to commit to putting in a certain amount of details and a certain amount of ambiguous areas without knowing the details and knowing the A, cost implications, and B, actual safety, the actual value to putting someone there.
You put the chief in an awkward position. I think you've heard from the town that they want a police chief.
To be reactive instead of, I mean, you keep saying if it's needed, does something bad have to happen?
Yes.
I think one of the great things about this community meeting is getting input. I have heard the community loud and clear. I will tell you, quite frankly, what the conversation we had with Massport prior to this was, let's see the input of the community, and I think that's what you said. So I think the input of the community is they want a police presence to keep their neighborhood safe.
Yes.
I work for the community of Bedford. With all due respect, I do not work for Massport, although we are partners. So based on the input I'm getting here, I think there'll be a follow-up conversation with Massport, and we want to meet the needs of the community. So if that requires police details, certainly. I want a police presence on our neighborhoods to keep our community safe.
Hi, I'm David Hercott. I grew up on Fayette, and I have nieces and nephews that live on South Road and on Fayette now. I have a concern about the air quality as far as the milling machines that you're going to be using. I'm not sure what you're utilizing for, like, dust control, misting, and for keeping the dust down off of the trucks. You mentioned that it's all subcontractors and whatever they decide. Do you have a health and safety environmental plan that the general contractor that you hired has provided? Is that what they adhere to, or is it Massport's health and safety plan?
So part of the contract is rules and regulations that are put into place by Massport as well, but the contractor does have their own health and safety plan in place.
Do they also have a QAQC and a health and safety guy that needs to be on the site at all times?
If it's,
usually required.
If it's a regulation, then they do. But I haven't seen it myself personally. So.
Okay, as far as tracking, because when you're milling, you make a lot of silica dust. I mean, that's basically what you're doing. You're making a powder, it's going into the back of the truck. The truck is now gonna traverse down the roads. It's going to be covered, we'll all see it covered, but it's a fine dust. It's going to go everywhere. Also, when you're milling down on the runway itself, if the wind is blowing the wrong way, if you're not properly misting it, if you're not keeping a check on them, it's just going to blow right down Linfield, right into Linfield, right over to Fayette, right down South Road, right into Fam Camp.
And you'll call me, right?
What's that?
You'll call me, right?
We shouldn't have to call you. Nobody should have to call you. You should have these checks and balances in place at all times. Every time I do a contract, I am required, always required.
This is in place. These plans are in place.
Why didn't you just say that? You don't tell me to call you. Tell me you have it in place.
The plans are in place.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Thank you for your time. So respectful of the community's time, this will be the last, let's do a last round. If not, this will be our last question. Certainly, I will remain available after to discuss anything with the residents. So this gentleman in the blue. And okay, we'll call it at.
Everybody's just gonna get up.
So why don't we do a last call for Q&A, and unless we see other people, we can certainly end it with, sir, do you have a question? Will you be the, ma'am? You'll be the last question of the night publicly, and then we'll certainly stay around for any input after. Sir, please.
I have a last question.
Okay, he'll be the last question. Sir, please identify yourself. And
my name is Mario Mendez. I live on Simon Ashby Road. A mile away from the end of 115. As a prior pilot, I love the fact that you'd be doing the runway. So everybody here understands that it's going to make a huge difference for planes landing and taking off, especially during wet conditions. Having said that, a few things. Now, you're going to use the other runway pretty much all the time. And the reason we have two runways, one of them is basically because of crosswinds. So when you have crosswinds, you close one runway, you open up the other one.
That's correct.
Now we increased air traffic in just the one runway. What kind of research have you done to guarantee the increased traffic over my house is not going to end up on a 747 crash into my bedroom tomorrow?
So a 747 PIC is responsible for his flight and...
No. That was a joke. I know large planes don't land here, but...
Like, you're a pilot. You want me to... Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to increase air traffic over my house and a lot of people's house. I mean, during crosswinds, it's not always optimal to do it. Are you going to close the other runway, depending on what kind of wind conditions we have, the weather, and just tell pilots to go elsewhere, or what's the plan?
So the runway wouldn't be closed. The ATIS, for those of you who don't fly, there's a weather report that goes out from the air traffic control tower that tells you what the prevailing winds are, and it's the responsibility of pilots always to determine if it's safe for them to land or not.
Right.
Or
so as a
choose an alternate route or an alternate airport.
Right. So as a private pilot, I can do that for commercial flights, but that's not always the case.
There are no commercial flights at Hanscom Field.
You know, the Celtics go in and out once in a while, but.
Yeah, there's charter flights, and that would be up to the charter flight operator.
Another one, if you could scroll the map up down a little bit, so you show Great Road. So I'm on Ashby, and to the right a little bit is the U-shaped street over there. So on the right side, you go up, that's Ashby, and from 3 to 6, I'm not allowed to take a left turn over there. There's a taxi-paying resident. So during rush hour, what's keeping us from having you guys from using our roads and just basically do all your work off of rush hour?
I'm not sure that I'm following you.
Don't have trucks out on the road during rush hour. Do it before and afterwards. So between, say,
so
10 and 3.
Our operation, so it will be before, during, and after.
All right, what's rush hour, guys? 7 through 9? 7 through 9 in the morning and say 3 and 7 in at night. Why not? Just, it's around the clock operation, so
sir,
work it all out.
Waiting. I certainly appreciate your comments. If you have a question for Massport, I'd ask you to...
That's the question. What keeps you from not operating these trucks during rush hour? I mean, is it just not an option?
So in order to get our project done in the 30 days, we're operating the entire time.
Okay, and that basically, if the weather doesn't contribute, extending the deadline.
Can they go overnight?
I'm sorry, can you repeat? I'm not sure that I'm...
So, if because of weather, the construction is not done on time, basically. You're going to have to go past that deadline, correct?
There is a possibility.
So why not go past
that
deadline by not running trucks during rush hour and school hours?
Well, if we operate the truck... So we're doing the project to be, you know, to have the truck traffic completed before school starts, which I believe is September 5th, right?
All right. The other thing is I work with high tech a lot, and why aren't these trucks equipped with a GPS tracking device that we can then later on confirm they're not speeding down the road?
I have no idea what kind of devices they're equipped with.
Can we find out?
We can certainly find out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, my name is Kevin Thompson. I live on 5 Tilden Street. If you can zoom in on it. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sorry. It's stage fright. You go to Tilden Street?
To the right.
To your right? Go straight in now?
Go
down? Go to
the
left?
The loop off the very end of South Road, closest to us.
Terrified. You know what I mean? Like I see the planes, the headlights are in my kids' windows. I mean, I keep the windows closed. I'm scared of everything. Everything everyone's talking about, I'm like ground zero. And there's a couple of people that live on my street. It's ground zero. I have 4 kids, 10 of them. I'm terrified. What do I do? I mean, the lights, it's going to keep them up. The air quality, there's just a chain link fence. I'm terrified. I really am. So I don't know if there's anything that's going to put a bigger fence up. But like the debris, the dust, I hear people talking about silicone. I mean, should I be nervous? Should I be worried?
Silica.
So, I mean, I don't know if you guys, if it's that car with the gas tank that's built in the back and it kept getting hit, it was cheaper just to pay the people up when they sued than replacing the pot. You know what I mean? What was that car called? Does anyone know what that car was? Saw with the gas tank on the back, and they kept getting an accident. People getting burnt. The Pinto. You know what the Pinto? You know the story about the Pinto? They made the Pinto, and the gas tank was in the back. People got rear-ended. They blew up. They died, and they found out it was cheaper to pay this lawsuits than it was to actually replace the recall car, right? So that's what I'm wondering. It's kind of like, oh, there's only three houses there. What kind of problems did they cause? You know, so. Was there anything in play? Because like I said, I still had lights in my windows and stuff like that, but now I'm worried that someone mentioned about the construction lights. Is that going to be my window? Should I leave all my windows? Do you guys know, should I leave my windows closed? Should I not let my kids outside during the day or certain hours? Are they going to be doing loud construction all night long? And beyond that, I mean, is there ever going to be two trucks passing each other? Or is it just in and out? And I know that you say trucks, and I know the number, people are saying the number, this and that, I don't care about the number, but that's dump trucks. That's not including contractors, pickup trucks, the guy, the supervisor that's coming by, someone's going to come and look on the thing. So there's a lot more, and I get that. I have kids, and there's kids all over, and they're driving up and down their bikes, and they're kids. They don't know any better. And, you know, I know that these guys, they're professionals, and they're going to be driving, but, you know, one guy's driving in the middle of the night. I mean, that kid's not going to be in the middle of the night, but one guy's dozing off, and if another truck's going to park.
Sir, actually, that's a great question. I'd like to ask Massport that. How many workers are anticipated? Besides that, we're talking
about only dump trucks going through that entrance, or is it everybody involved in the
How
truck?
Many workers will actually be
on the site?
On the site, and will they be traveling the same routes, or will they be coming in a different entrance?
So I apologize, I didn't look into the numbers of how many workers would be on site for you for tonight, but I'll definitely get the numbers to you.
Yeah, I think everyone was talking about the dump trucks, and I was getting irritated because I want to see something, but it's not just the dump. Dump trucks are big and scary. And all that, but I mean, and I live there. I'm a Cambridge firefighter, so I'm home. I'm a stay-home dad, like Mr. Mom. But I'm home all day long with the kids if I'm not going somewhere. So I see, you know, all the traffic, all the planes during the day, all the cars that go down there. And I guess another last question I want to come in more time, but does that include street sweepers? Because the last time you guys did a project, the dirt all over the road, and then it gets into my street, and then into my driveway.
We have a street sweeper on site. We'll have one on site 24/7.
Oh, so and they'll be going up the road, though? I'm sorry, let me interrupt.
So whenever we get a call that there's been any sort of, if there's been dust or debris,
I'll call you.
You absolutely can.
All right, so yeah, and they're not allowed to stage on the field that's.
So the sweeper's on this.
Can you go to the left, sir? My left, your right.
Yeah.
Right there, a lot of people stage in there, and that's a big mess. So they're not allowed. If I see them, I can be the watchdog and say they're not allowed to pull in there and loose. I mean, any of the trucks or anything, they pull over, whatever, smoke a cigarette or whatever, because that'll make a mess on the street, too. It's horrendous.
They shouldn't be pulling in there. That's actually your first property.
But I can call you about my complaints. If it's a heavy, I mean, I get the odor. I hear the smell of jet fuel. I can only afford it. It was near the Air Force Base. I knew it. But if it gets bad, I can call you direct if I have concerns.
You can.
Absolutely.
I gave out the number earlier. I'll give it out again. It's 781-869-8060.
And then, sir, we'll follow up to see how many workers will be on the project, and if we can determine which routes they'll be taking in to try to minimize the impact. I see that if they are in personal vehicles, I see no reason why they have to take those designated truck routes, but that's something I'll be following.
Because I also realize, Chief, as a police officer, you're only allowed to address the law. You can't say, you can be a watchdog, but I feel safer with you around in the police department, absolutely. But you're not here to enforce, you had 20 trucks or there's four extra trucks. That's not your job. And I don't know if anyone realizes that. He would just be there for the safety. They're not. So, I mean, and I feel safer and I always love to have you guys around. But, I mean, that's all I'm saying. I'm not complaining. I'm concerned. I'm terrified once again. I can see everything going on and there most of the time. So.
Thank you for your comments, sir.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, and on the construction lighting end of things, this was a similar concern when they just went through resurfacing in Logan. And the lights are focused on the runway, not on the surrounding neighborhoods, which, they are very much dialed in on that. And we did not see, even with immediate abutters, the impact was, I don't think I got a single complaint about that. So, usually that is by design. They're trying to light themselves. The last thing they want to do is it's not a plane taking off with lights in front of it, it's, ground lighting, so they can see what they're working on.
Okay, yeah, like I said, come by for coffee, something at my house, and you can see everything from my house, my window, my backyard.
Is that, for the record, Coffee, always. Cops love donuts.
Donuts. Always walk with you guys.
Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Don't have donuts.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ewan Urquhart, and my daughter lives on Fayette Road. Okay. And, you know, it seems to me the thing here is the reason they're going down South Road and that, and not using the base entrances, is because you're worried about the traffic across the live runways. And, you know, you have air traffic controls, and if you had trucks backed up four each and then moving over across, how long would that take? 10 minutes at the most? And you mean the air traffic controls couldn't control that? I was in the Air Force for 4 years, and I very rarely, and in fact, I don't ever remember an air traffic controller making an error. And, you know, what would that be? It would save so much agony for all these people if that was done.
Thank you for your comments. We'll allow Massport to respond.
Yeah, I'll just try to be as brief as possible answering you. So keeping in mind the Hanscom Field is the busiest general aviation airport in all of New England, and we're only second busiest behind Logan Airport. Our air traffic controllers are very, very busy. And it really was looked at from a safety standpoint, that it wouldn't be safe to try to use air traffic controllers.
The air traffic controller couldn't control it?
They are in charge of air traffic.
Pardon?
Air traffic.
Yeah, air traffic. Yeah. I'm not sure.
Sir, I think what Massport is saying, with due respect, sir, is that the air traffic controllers control the air path, the flight path, not the ground.
So they're controlling their primary purpose.
Everything on the ground.
They do, but their primary concern is obviously the safety of the air traffic. And the directive is to keep as much vehicle traffic off of active aircraft movement areas.
You're saying they would ignore traffic on the runway?
Of course not.
You know, when they have tugs and that are towing planes, they have to control that.
Yes, you know, of course.
And if they
and
have
vehicle traffic as well, but
pardon?
They control vehicle traffic as well. But the directive for safety at all airports is to keep as much vehicle traffic off of aircraft movement areas as possible.
Whether it's airplanes or otherwise, right?
Vehicle traffic. Vehicle traffic should be kept off as much as possible.
So
only with an absolute operational need should a vehicle be on an aircraft movement area.
So essentially, you're saying that they couldn't handle it.
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. I think our air traffic controllers are fantastic, but we are the busiest general aviation airport in all of New England, and they'll be very busy dealing with all the air traffic. And as I said before, the directive is to keep airplanes in the aircraft movement areas and keep vehicles out of the aircraft movement areas as much as possible. And that's safest for all, and that's something that they do at airports across the country.
There will be vehicles going across those runways, and the air traffic controller will be controlling them. You know, it's a new system for the air traffic controller?
I don't think that it's changed, but I'm not certain. You'd have to ask the FAA. We always try to keep the vehicles out of the path of aircraft as much as possible, which is as safe as possible for all of us.
Yes. Well, if you scheduled it so they did four at a time, they'd know every single hour how many were going across, and they visually see all that stuff. You know, so I don't really buy the argument. Thank you.
Thank you for your time, sir.
Hi, I'm Heather Patterson.
Hi, Heather.
398 South Road, right at the end. So my question is, the trucks are paid by the truckload, right? To remove product?
It's all in the contract.
So it's all quoted, or it's by the truckload?
It's by the truckload, as far as I know.
So these trucks are going to be in a hurry to get in and out. They're going to be going down our streets. What is the posted speed limit that they have to be going?
They have to go the posted speed limit on all
roads. What will it be in this? Because there's so many trucks, I would assume that there'd be...
So if your speed limit is 25, then the speed limit is 25.
It's not going to decrease
at all? If your speed limit is 20, then it's...
Wouldn't it have to decrease?
No.
We can't arbitrarily, by state law, we can't arbitrarily decrease the speed limit. There's something called speed greater than reasonable and proper, and that is something we'll monitor. So the posted speed limit is a thickly settled zone, which we cannot change without doing a traffic study, getting approved through DOT. But there's also something called speed greater than reasonable and proper. A loaded vehicle in a residential area with kids playing, even if there's a posted speed limit, there is an expectation based on weather conditions and all those other factors I mentioned of vehicles operating at a lower than posted speed.
Well, I don't think our end of town, we don't even have posted speed limits. So I think that needs to be addressed by tomorrow, because nobody's going to know what the posted speed limit is if you guys aren't going to know.
Isn't there a speed limit sign out there right now?
Oh, yes, there's one.
Which one? The last year's construction sign?
During a previous project, and they agreed to 20 miles per hour. There's one construction vehicle's 20 miles per hour on the right-hand side of South Road heading towards the family campground.
But that's not even a town speed limit. So there's one tiny one, and it's pretty hidden.
It's
we know it because we drive it all the time. Yeah.
They've already agreed to provide more.
And so is that going to be up tomorrow?
20 miles an hour?
So in that very end there, the contractor agreed to put up slow signs. Specifically what they were planning on posting for speed limits, I'm not certain that they were listing actual speed limits.
Because I would think the project, is it starting first thing tomorrow morning?
It is small, yes, it's starting.
So wouldn't they have been out there today posting these?
They should be driving the roads right now, actually, and looking at where they need to put signs. There's certain construction signs that are going,
Carver Road. When can we expect
They haven't given me a time yet.
So can we get a time from you tomorrow?
Yeah.
And then once, if we all know construction never finishes when it says it's going to. So when it goes over in the end, on August 30th, for the bulk of the trucks going through, is there a fine in place?
So in the contract, there's built-in fees per day for the contractor when they go over.
Which is how much?
So it's obviously in their best interest. I couldn't tell you off the top of my head how much that is.
I'm pretty sure 2 weeks ago when I went to the meeting, you had said it was $5,000 a day.
It's somewhere.
Right, and does Bedford see that money, or where does that money go to?
So that goes towards the project.
Towards Massport?
It's a Massport contract, yes.
So we actually don't benefit in any way. Our town won't benefit in any way from this.
Other than getting the project done before school starts. No. I mean, the benefit would be finishing the project on time so that you're hassled for the shortest amount of time possible.
So on September 1st, when it does go over, we're not going to see any benefit from that?
So the project is 30, the majority of the project is 30 days, but I did say that the project is going to approximately the 15th to 18th.
You did say that the bulk of the trucks are going to
be done
by the 30th.
But they're not completely stopping after that. It's just the majority of all the paving will be done by then.
So we have a month of living nightmare, and then we're not going to see any benefit from any of this. There's nothing in place for the South Road end of it. Right now you're paving part of Hartwell because you had already planned to do that, but there's nothing on our end. I mean, in front of my house, I have 18 feet to the front of my steps. So those trucks, and I have no berm along my yard. None of the houses do. So I can just see I'm going to have mounds of dirt, which I already can't grow anything because it's already just... The road is so narrow, you can't have, if any of the fam camp Winnebagos come by, nothing else can go by. You have to wait until those pass, so I don't know how this is going to happen.
So, I mean, I understand I'm hearing your frustration just living there in general, but I'm not sure that I'm understanding your frustration increase over the project itself.
I'm just curious, all the wear and tear on the roads, it's not, there's...
Right.
And the fact that you're not going to be able to have a construction truck coming down the street and then having one of the Winnebagos, I mean, they typically all leave by September, so some of them will probably be leaving during August.
Yeah.
They're going to bump into each other. Where are those trucks going to go? They're going to go on my lawn. That's where they're going to go.
Because we don't even have curbs.
We don't have curbs, so there's nothing there to stop them.
Has Massport, I heard earlier tonight, has Massport committed to repair any damage?
We haven't, yeah.
So,
well, damage, but then how, so...
On summer as well?
So anything
on the roots, on the road along our halberd.
So that's just to the road? I mean, my yard, I should probably just document all of it, and, you know, I can tell you I'm going to have tire marks going through it, because I already do when people are, when two things are coming, the road is very narrow. I'm just shocked that nobody's done a survey of any of it.
I mean, certainly if a construction truck were to put tire tracks on your road, we want you to let us know that so that we can deal with that and fix it. I mean, it's not ending at a curb. If there was a situation where there was damage, naturally we would fix that. We, you know, that's a part of the construction management.
So I use the curb as an example, but if we did any damage anywhere, we would fix it.
Okay, thank you.
Hello? Okay. Thanks for letting me know last, sir. Colin Valentine, 26 Putnam. And the good news from my perspective is my only impact is on increased traffic and going back and forth to work. One statement, there's a few people I think we've forgotten here. So you're limiting traffic through South Road, Summer Street to 16 hours a day, assuming everything goes well, right? But the other entrance is 24/7, correct?
Correct.
So there's a lot of people living from the Concord Road exit in Billerica all the way down Route 4, all the way down to Hartwell Road. They're going to be impacted 24/7, particularly in the middle of the night when that road is typically relatively quiet, I think, the few times I've traveled late at night. So we shouldn't forget those people. Secondly, a little more specific question, a very specific question. I've been doing government contracting for 31 years now. You have a budget. You went and got an approved budget for this job. You got a contract. How much money have you set aside and do you have available under your spending authority to pay for police details or pay for street repairs or car repairs? What is that dollar amount?
I'm not aware of what that dollar amount is myself personally.
We need to get that because I hear a lot of glib promises, to be blunt. Having done contracting, if I don't have the money, I can't pay for it. And you don't even know the amount.
So, at Hanscom Field, we've had a lot of issues come up where we didn't have money for it, but we did certainly pay for things that needed to be paid for, whether or not we had a budget for it. So, you know, regardless of what the budget is, if there is some damage that we do, we will fix it.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Do we have a closing statement from Massport, or are we just...
No, I think I've already said, I know that this is difficult. This project is going to be difficult for all of us. I appreciate you coming. I've heard everything that you said, and if there's anything that there's a follow-up for, Anthony, you know, wrote it down for me so that I can get back to you. There's the project number, 781-869-8060, and then there's the link to the website that we did put up there as well. And the updates on the project and the project progress will be posted on a regular basis.
Very, very quick. When did you first get in touch with Tal about this project?
So this project was in our 5-year capital improvement plan, and we started briefing the Hanscom Field Advisory Commission, which is our legislative group, our outlet for informing the towns. It consists of area town groups and selectmen from all four towns back in April of 2016.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Don't forget to register, sign in, so that people, the town knows that you care and knows where you're coming from. Thank you so much.